But again, thank you for joining us. This is a series that we have partnered with the Survivorship Program through the Blum Resource Center. And we have a monthly topic on survivorship. So we're very excited to have that for you all. And we will get started. So today's topic is I had cancer. Now I have to worry about my heart. And I'm sorry, I don't want to mispronounce your name. It's Dr.
Nohria.
Nohria. Well, thank you so much for being with us. And we're very excited to hear your presentation today. So we will get started whenever you're ready.
Great. Thank you for inviting me. I am a heart failure and transplant physician by training, and I run the cardio-oncology program within the survivorship group at Dana-Farber and Brigham and Women's Hospital. And I wanted to briefly talk about some of the cardiac issues that patients who have a history of cancer or who are undergoing active cancer therapy need to think about. These are my disclosures. So what this slide shows is that if we look at the causes of death within the US, we can see that heart disease is the number one killer in the US, and this is followed closely by cancer, which comes in at second place. However, as cancer therapies are improving, the number of people who are surviving their cancer continues to grow on an annual basis. Currently, there are about 16 million people in the US who have survived their cancer, and this number is expected to increase to about 25 million by the year 2020. So what do people who survive their cancer die from? And as you can see here, shown in the red, heart disease remains the single largest cause of non-cancer-related death in cancer survivors, followed closely by cerebrovascular disease, which includes things like stroke. So if you look at the red and the maroon bars in total, you can see that heart disease is a significant problem in cancer survivors and needs to be taken seriously. Now, why might this be? So I think the first thing that it is important to stress is that cancer and heart disease share many common risk factors. Importantly, as we get older, our risk of developing cancer and heart disease goes up significantly. Partly, this is because of environmental factors that we all are faced with as we get older. But we're beginning to realize now that there may be genetic factors that also contribute to this link between cancer and heart disease with aging. One such genetic factor is something known as CHIP, or clonal hematopoiesis of indeterminate origin. These are mutations that we acquire as we get older, again, due to environmental factors, our habits, our lifestyle, etc. And it has been shown that some of these mutations that we acquire with aging not only increase our risk for heart disease, but also increase our risk for developing hematopoietic cancers, such as leukemias and lymphomas. So again, there are genetic factors that go along with aging that increase the risk for both diseases. Lifestyle issues such as tobacco use are associated with the development of heart disease, but also with the development of lung cancer, renal cell carcinoma, et cetera. Certain viral infections can predispose us to developing both heart disease and cancer. Diet, we know that obesity and unhealthy lifestyle where we don't exercise regularly can increase the risk of several cancers such as breast cancer, colorectal cancer, and also the risk of heart disease. So again, there are many common shared risk factors that can affect both diseases. And importantly, what this study shows is that if you follow the 7 healthy lifestyle steps that are recommended to reduce your risk of heart disease, such as smoking cessation, doing at least 150 minutes of moderate activity per week, controlling your cholesterol, keeping your blood pressure less than 130 over 80 millimeters of mercury, eating a healthy, low fat, and low red meat diet, keeping your weight within an appropriate BMI range of 20 to 25, and keeping your blood sugar within normal limits reduces your risk of heart disease. But what this study showed is that if you follow these factors, the more of them you follow, and this is if you follow zero, if you follow one, and so on, your risk of developing new cancer or incident cancer also goes down significantly. Again, suggesting that having a healthy lifestyle not only reduces your risk of heart disease, but also your risk of malignancy. Additionally, what people like I primarily deal with is that there are many cancer therapies that can have significant cardiovascular side effects either while you are undergoing the therapy or even as late-term side effects of these therapies. So one of the side effects that we worry about is ventricular dysfunction or weakening of the heart muscle, also known as cardiomyopathy or heart failure. And several drugs such as anthracyclines, commonly known as doxorubicin or daunorubicin or epirubicin, can give rise to this. Many HER2 blockers that are used to treat HER2-positive breast cancer or HER2-positive GI malignancies, such as Herceptin, TDM1, et cetera, can give you cardiac dysfunction. MEK inhibitors that are treated used to treat melanoma or certain lung cancers can also give you weakening of the heart muscle. Same thing with osimertinib, which is a drug used to treat lung cancer. And then many immunotherapies, which are becoming very popular nowadays, namely checkpoint inhibitors, things like pembrolizumab, nivolumab, et cetera, can also cause cardiac muscle dysfunction. VEGF inhibitors, drugs that are used to cut off the blood supply to the growing tumor, are often associated with the development of high blood pressure. Proteasome inhibitors, such as Velcade or carfilzomib, that are used to treat multiple myeloma, can also give rise to high blood pressure. Many cancer drugs can give rise to cardiac ischemia or can lead to heart attacks. And these are drugs such as 5-FU, which is used to treat colorectal cancer, capecitabine, again, which is used to treat colorectal cancer or breast cancer. Several drugs that are used to treat chronic myelogenous leukemia, such as nilotinib, ponatinib. People who have received chest radiation can go on later in life to develop cardiac ischemia. And then certain drugs such as Revlimid, pomalidomide, thalidomide, et cetera, can also increase your risk for developing ischemia. There are newer agents that can give rise to heart rhythm abnormalities. The most famous is ibrutinib, which is used to treat chronic lymphocytic leukemia. Drugs that are used to treat lung cancer, et cetera, such as cisplatin or crizotinib, can slow your heart rate. Sometimes this can even require a pacemaker. And then again, immunotherapy, if you develop cardiac complications, can give rise to a slow heart rate where you may need a pacemaker. And then radiation therapy, especially if you are very far out from chest radiation, can cause several types of heart rate complications, either a fast heart rate or a slow heart rate, where again, you may require a pacemaker. And then lastly, cancer itself promotes blood clot formation. So many cancer patients develop blood clots in their legs or in their lungs. And certain drugs that are used to treat cancer can increase this risk even further. So I thought I would present three cases that I saw in my clinic that kind of emphasize these cardiotoxicities and what we would recommend doing about them. So the first patient was a woman named F.A. She was a 63-year-old woman who had triple-positive breast cancer that was diagnosed in 2006. She had a right mastectomy and received chemotherapy with 5-FU, epirubicin, and cyclophosphamide. She also got chest radiation to the right breast, and she received Herceptin. Unfortunately, about 13 cycles into her Herceptin, she was noted to have a decline in her cardiac function to 45%. 50% or more is considered to be normal. At that time, she had almost completed 1 year of Herceptin, so they decided to truncate her treatment, and they transitioned her to an aromatase inhibitor called letrozole, which she took for the next 5 years. Unfortunately, 8 years later, she presented with metastatic disease to the bones and the lining of the lungs. And at that time, she received a short course of treatment with paclitaxel, Herceptin, pertuzumab, and was then noted to have worsening of her cardiac function with a further decline in her ejection fraction to 35%. And at that point, she was sent to me because obviously she needed to continue on some sort of HER2 blockade for her breast cancer, ideally, but at the same time, they didn't want her to develop worsening heart failure in the bargain. So what do we know about why this happened to her? So anthracyclines, which is part of the drugs that she got when she was originally diagnosed with breast cancer in 2006, increase your risk of heart failure in a dose-dependent fashion. So as you can see, the higher the dose, the higher the risk of developing heart failure. Most women who get treated for breast cancer get about 240 milligrams per meter squared. So even though the risk is not very high at low doses, it is not zero. Trastuzumab or Herceptin, which is commonly used to treat HER2-positive breast cancers, can also increase your risk of developing cardiac dysfunction. About 13% of women who are treated with HER2 blockers develop an asymptomatic decline in their cardiac function, and about 2% of them go on to develop symptomatic heart failure in studies where this has been looked at in a systematic fashion. Luckily, if you catch it early, it can be reversed with heart failure or cardiac medications, and also often you may have to hold the drug for a short time. However, many women will have normalization of their cardiac function, and if they can continue on the cardiac medications, you can reintroduce HER2 blockers and they can finish their treatment successfully. There has been a significant advance in HER2 blockade, and there are many new drugs that are currently available, such as pertuzumab, lapatinib, T-DM1, and HER2. And many of these, such as T-DM1 and HER2, can actually be used instead of trastuzumab or Herceptin. They have less cardiac toxicity, as you can see, only 2.7% and 1.6% as opposed to 13%. However, these drugs are conjugated to other chemotherapeutic molecules, and therefore they may have other systemic side effects that are worse than those experienced with Herceptin. So again, it's a trade-off, but in a person who is at particularly high risk for cardiac toxicity or who develops cardiac toxicity, one could consider switching to these alternatives. So what do we consider to be the risk factors for developing cardiotoxicity? As I showed you, high dose anthracycline exposure. In general, we say that anyone getting doxorubicin at more than 250 milligrams per meter squared or epirubicin at greater than 600 milligrams per meter squared is at high risk. High dose chest radiation exceeding 35 gray, especially if it involves the heart. So any left-sided radiation where the heart is in the radiation field can put you at excess risk. Combination therapy with anthracyclines and chest radiation or anthracyclines followed by trastuzumab or Herceptin is also considered to be an increased risk. Now the oncologists have gotten good about this and they've come up with chest radiation techniques where you try to keep the heart out of the radiation field as much as possible. So in the case of breast cancer, this involves deep breath hold when you do radiation. So when you do that, the chest wall moves away from the heart and you're able to reduce the degree of radiation to the heart. They can also do prone radiation where you lie face down and the breast swings out of the radiation. The heart and the breast are separated and therefore you are able to reduce the amount of radiation to the heart. But importantly, the older you are, if your age is over 60, you are at increased risk. If you have underlying cardiovascular risk factors, such as hypertension, hyperlipidemia, tobacco use, you are at increased risk for developing cardiotoxicity. And if you have any pre-existing heart disease, such as a borderline cardiac function to begin with, more than moderate valvular heart disease, or a prior heart attack, your risk goes up with any dose of anthracyclines or trastuzumab. So what do we recommend to try and reduce your cardiovascular risk while you are undergoing cancer therapy? So first of all, I know that when people get diagnosed with cancer, they sort of get overwhelmed by that diagnosis, and there is a tendency to forget about all your other medical issues. And that's understandable because it's a lot to deal with. However, given the interplay between cancer treatment and cardiac disease, it is very important to make sure that your oncologist or your physician analyzes your cardiac risk factors and makes sure that they are well controlled. So for instance, if you have high blood pressure, you want to make sure that your blood pressure is consistently less than 130 over 80. If you have high cholesterol, you want to make sure that you're taking a statin to try and reduce your cholesterol, et cetera. And in general, we recommend getting a baseline echocardiogram, especially if you are someone who is over the age of 60 or have pre-existing disease or are going to get high-dose therapy. In general, during cancer treatment, you want to make sure that your blood pressure, cholesterol, all these things are routinely followed and modified appropriately. If you are a particularly high-risk person, you and your oncologist should discuss cardioprotective medications such as ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, and in some cases, we even give a drug called dextroxazine along with chemotherapy that has been shown to reduce the risk of developing heart disease. If you develop any symptoms that are concerning for heart disease, you want to bring them to the attention of your oncologist. And then in general, we do recommend doing surveillance echocardiograms to assess your cardiac function after you have received 250 milligrams per meter squared of anthracyclines. And if you're getting high dose therapies, such as for sarcoma or lymphoma, they recommend getting an echo after every 1 to 2 cycles beyond 250 milligrams per meter squared. And in those women who are receiving trastuzumab or Herceptin, they recommend getting an echo every 3 months during therapy. Now, if you have metastatic disease and you're going to get Herceptin for the rest of your life, that interval may be widened out to reduce the burden of getting echocardiograms on the patient. In general, once you have completed therapy, you still want to continue to modify your risk. You still want to go for an annual visit where you are assessed for cardiac symptoms. And in general, they recommend getting an echo 1 year after completion of therapy, regardless of whether you got anthracyclines alone or whether or not you got anthracyclines followed by trastuzumab or Herceptin. If you received these agents as a child, either for childhood leukemia, childhood lymphoma, etc., the guidelines for screening are a little more stringent. Children have developing hearts, and therefore, if you were treated before the age of 21 and particularly before the age of 18, your heart is more susceptible to injury, and therefore, your lifetime risk of having a cardiovascular complication goes up significantly compared to an adult. In general, the childhood oncology guidelines have come up with screening intervals that should be followed with echocardiography. If you received low-dose anthracycline-based chemotherapy or low-dose radiation, you don't require any screening. However, if you got moderate dose or you got combination therapy, you should get an echo every 2 to 5 years. And if you got high-dose therapy, you should get an echo every 2 years. It's particularly important to note that if you were treated as a child and you are now planning to become pregnant, you may have some subclinical disease. And then during pregnancy, your blood volume more than doubles, and that can put a significant load on the heart. And therefore, if you are someone who were treated as a child and you're planning to become pregnant, you should make sure that you have a baseline assessment of your cardiac function early in your pregnancy. Because if you have pre-existing cardiac dysfunction, you're at very high risk for developing symptomatic heart failure during your pregnancy. That can then affect the health of not only the mother, but also of the child. On the other hand, if you are fine at the beginning, then you should have an echocardiogram done at the end of your second trimester or at the beginning of your third trimester, which is when your blood volume really increases. And if at that time you are noted to have a problem, your obstetrician can work with cardiology to manage you appropriately and to time your delivery accordingly. So what happened to our patient? So she had an elevated blood pressure. She was overweight and her cholesterol was very poorly controlled, as you can see here, with a total cholesterol of 259, normal being less than 200, and an LDL of 183, normal being less than 100. She did have type 2 diabetes that was well controlled, and she had a relatively inactive lifestyle with a very poor functional capacity. 4.6 METs is basically the equivalent of being able to climb a flight of stairs. So what did we do for her? We started her on blood pressure and cholesterol medications. We referred her to a cardiac rehab program to help her exercise and get into a more healthy lifestyle. Over time, her cardiac function improved from 49 to 55%. She was taken off her HER2-positive therapy and was started on alternative cancer therapies by her oncologist. And she did well for the next 2 years, but unfortunately, ultimately, her cancer progressed and she died in hospice care in 2018. Another patient that I commonly see in my practice for late complications of cancer therapy is shown here. This is patient JD. He's a 52-year-old man who was treated for stage 2B Hodgkin's lymphoma at the age of 19. And at that time, he received ABVD chemotherapy and radiation to the mantle field, which extends basically from the chin to the bottom of his sternum. ABVD consists of anthracyclines, bleomycin, vincristine, and dexamethasone. And as I mentioned before, anthracyclines can have long-term cardiac toxicity. He's a very active man who routinely runs and skis, and he has no other cardiac risk factors. And one day, he fainted without warning after dinner while he was out with some friends. He thought it was nothing. He just thought that he probably was dehydrated, etc., and didn't really seek attention. However, 1 month later, he noticed that he was becoming more and more short of breath and lightheaded with any activity. So in this regard, he showed up for an appointment, and we found when we did an EKG that he had something called complete heart block, which basically means that the top chambers of the heart that contain the native pacemaker were essentially not communicating with the lower chambers of the heart that are that essentially cause your heart to beat or squeeze and eject blood to the rest of the body. Luckily for him, his lower chambers had an intrinsic rhythm of about 40 beats per minute. So he did not die because of this rhythm abnormality. But when we see this, we sent him urgently for a pacemaker placement that would allow the top and bottom chambers of his heart to communicate appropriately. But we were curious as to why someone like him, who was so active and young, would have developed this problem. And so we did a cardiac catheterization, and it showed that he had a tight stenosis in the main coronary artery of his heart, and he underwent an angioplasty and stent placement. He did well for the next 2 years, but then he came in with recurrent shortness of breath and lightheadedness. And at this point, he was found to have valvular heart disease with tightening of his aortic valve, which is the valve that goes from the heart to the rest of the body, and leakiness of his mitral valve, which is the valve between the big and little chambers on the left side of the heart. So why is this that this very young man in his 50s is facing all of these problems? So we know that chest radiation, especially in high doses, if given to the heart, can cause many long-term complications. So if you look at Hodgkin's lymphoma survivors, especially those survivors who were treated in the 1980s and the 1990s, have a six-fold higher risk of developing heart disease than age-matched controls. The risk of developing coronary artery disease is about 4 to 6-fold higher. The risk of developing valvular heart disease, both in terms of tightening of the valves and leakiness of the valves, and often more than one valve can be involved, is about 9-fold higher. There is about a 2-fold higher risk of requiring a pacemaker. And then there is about a 5-fold higher risk of having heart failure, either because of the other complications that I've mentioned above, or because of stiffening of the heart muscle itself, which becomes scarred because of radiation. And then their risk of dying from cardiovascular disease is about 2 to 12-fold higher than age-matched controls. Breast cancer radiation, especially the left side, if the heart is in the field, is also associated with an increased risk of developing coronary artery disease and increased risk of cardiac death, although the doses used and the techniques used are much better, and therefore you don't get as much valvular heart disease or other complications from breast radiation therapy. Again, the higher the dose of radiation that the heart receives, the higher the risk of developing cardiac complications. And again, the oncologists, and especially the radiation oncologists, have become very cognizant of this. And nowadays they do things like involved field radiation therapy, where instead of blasting the whole chest, they essentially just give radiations to those lymph nodes or those areas that have the cancer rather than giving it to the whole chest. They can also do things like proton beam therapy, where the beams are not as penetrant and therefore they're more superficial and they just go to the cancer and don't affect deep components of the chest wall cavity, such as the heart. But again, in some people, the cancer can be very close to the heart or can even involve the heart. And in those situations, it is very hard to avoid the heart, and you can go on to develop complications later in life, like I discussed before with our patient. So again, what can you do to prevent this? The key is risk factor assessment and modification. You can't help the fact that you got radiation therapy. Your radiation oncologist can try to reduce that risk at the time of treatment, but if you did end up getting high exposure to the heart, that is something that you cannot avoid later in life. And therefore, the only other thing you can do is to make sure that other risk factors that impact your risk of developing heart disease are monitored and modified appropriately. Because we know that there is this increased risk, people need to be vigilant for cardiac symptoms, meaning if they get exertional chest pain, if they get short of breath when they exert themselves, if they notice that they have a hard time breathing when they lie down, if they start developing swelling in the legs, etc., all of these are signs and symptoms that are concerning for heart disease. And you should bring them to the attention of your primary care, your oncologist, or whoever it is that is seeing you. And in general, because we know that people who receive chest radiation, especially for things like Hodgkin's lymphoma, and especially again, if you were treated in the 1980s or 1990s, you should get surveillance echoes and stress tests starting about 5 to 10 years after radiation therapy, and then every 5 years thereafter. And obviously, if you have concerning symptoms, then we would do them at that time as needed. In general, if you do develop complications related to radiation therapy, people who have received radiation tend to have worse outcomes with cardiac surgery compared to people who have not received radiation. So this is a study from Cleveland Clinic where they took patients who had problems like blockages in the blood vessels of the heart or valvular heart disease and needed surgery, and compared them to those patients who had had prior chest radiation. And as you can see, their survival in chest radiation patients was much worse than those who had not received radiation therapy. And this was even further accentuated if it was a redo operation. And why might this be? This is because if you've received radiation, first of all, as I showed you before, you can have many parts of the heart involved. So the surgery tends to be longer. The longer the surgery, the worse the outcomes. Secondly, you get a lot of scarring of the chest wall itself. And therefore, even just opening up the chest and isolating the heart can be more complicated because you have a lot of adhesions, a lot of scarring, which can increase the time of the surgery and also increase the risk of bleeding and infection. And lastly, the lungs also get radiated in people who receive chest radiation. And the lungs are very important, both in your ability to get extubated, not develop post-operative pneumonias, not develop fluid collections between the lungs and the chest wall. And all of these things contribute to your long-term survival after surgery. So in general, nowadays we have many non-surgical ways of dealing with heart disease. So if you have coronary artery disease, you can get an angioplasty and stenting. If you have aortic valve disease, you can get something known as transcatheter aortic valve replacement, where like a stent, they go in through the groin and they essentially blow open the valve that is tight and they install a new valve in that old valve via a catheter-based approach. Again, you should be evaluated for these non-invasive approaches or non-surgical approaches, I should say. And if you are a candidate, those are preferred over surgery in radiation survivors. However, there are some instances where surgery is the best option, either because you have many blood vessels or multiple problems, and therefore surgery is one fix. And if you are going to get surgery, you should go to a center that has people who are familiar with doing surgery in patients who have had radiation in the past. In general, the aorta can be very calcified, something called porcelain aorta. So again, your doctors will assess for this, and that may affect how you are put on the bypass machine. You should have some evaluation for radiation-induced lung disease to understand how best to do intubation for the surgery, and also to give you realistic expectations of what to expect in terms of pneumonia and chest tube placement after surgery. And in general, if you have a moderately tight valve, it should be fixed at that time to try and avoid the need for reoperation. In general, for our patient, he was evaluated for a catheter-based mitral and aortic valve replacement. His mitral valve anatomy was not suitable, and therefore he underwent surgery. He had heart failure after surgery that required prolonged IV diuretics. His chest tubes were in for a little bit longer because his lymphatics and the lungs were not able to clear the fluid, and he needed them to be there for a little while longer for his pleural effusions. And ultimately he recovered, and now he is doing well. Lastly, I would like to talk about a third patient that I often see in clinic. This is a patient MW. She's a 70-year-old woman with metastatic lung cancer who is being treated with an immune checkpoint inhibitor called pembrolizumab or Keytruda. Basically, immune checkpoint inhibitors are drugs that take the brakes off the immune system, activate your immune system, and allow it to more effectively kill the tumor. These are being used very successfully in many solid cancers, and their use is expanding on a daily basis. The poster child for the use of these drugs was Jimmy Carter, who got them for melanoma. And as we all know, he is still surviving today and doing a good job. So 2 months into her treatment, she presented with drooping eyelids and diffuse muscle weakness. And laboratory evaluation showed that her muscle and cardiac enzymes were elevated, suggesting that she had some muscle and heart damage. So checkpoint inhibitors, unfortunately, can cause cardiotoxicity. Primarily, they can cause something called myocarditis, which is where the checkpoint inhibitor revs up the immune system. The immune system, for some reason, attacks the heart and causes heart damage. In this situation, you can get problems with the electrical system of the heart, such that you can need a pacemaker. Immune activation can also cause rupture of cholesterol plaque within the heart and clot formation, giving rise to a heart attack. And in some people, you can also get something called stress cardiomyopathy. This, fortunately, is a very rare complication that occurs in less than 1% of people, but the risk goes up if you are treated with dual checkpoint inhibitors. Many people get combination therapy with ipilimumab and pembrolizumab, or ipilimumab and nivolumab. And if you get dual blockade, that risk goes up significantly. So in general, if someone complains of symptoms like our patient, you want to stop the immune checkpoint inhibitor because you basically want to try and put the brakes on their immune system. You want to look for cardiac enzymes. You want to check an EKG. Cardiac MRI is a very good way of seeing whether the immune system is attacking the heart, because the heart lights up and it's swollen and you can see that there is inflammation within the heart. And in some instances, you may even need to undergo a cardiac biopsy, which can be done through a catheter that is put in through your neck. And that is often the gold standard for showing whether or not your immune system is attacking your heart as a result of your checkpoint inhibitor therapy. If you do find that your heart is being attacked, it is very important that you be treated with high dose prednisone right off the bat. Often these checkpoint inhibitor effects can last in your bloodstream for a very long time. So you have to be on these steroids for a long time, and they have to be tapered very slowly based on your cardiac labs. You may need additional immunosuppression, especially if the cardiac function is causing you to become unstable from a clinical standpoint, meaning low blood pressure, heart failure, et cetera. And in general, you cannot resume immune checkpoint inhibitors if you have this problem, primarily because if your immune system gets revved up again, you could have the same problem again. And if you do develop this problem and it goes untreated, it can be lethal in up to 50% of cases. So what did we do for our patient? We stopped her pembrolizumab. We started her on very high dose steroids. Neurology was involved, and they diagnosed her with a condition called myasthenia gravis, which was causing her eyelids to be droopy. It can also affect her swallowing. And then she also had skeletal muscle damage called myositis, and that was what was giving her her weakness when she was trying to walk and do other things. Interestingly, her cardiac MRI was negative, so the cardiac enzyme leakage was just an innocent bystander effect, because skeletal muscle can also release some degree of cardiac enzymes. And we did a biopsy just to confirm that cardiac involvement was not there, and it did not show any cardiac involvement. So as a result of the lack of cardiac involvement, her steroids were tapered more rapidly, and the oncologist did not feel comfortable restarting her on checkpoint inhibitor therapy, and her therapy was accordingly changed. So what are the take-home points from this talk? I think what I hope I have convinced you is that having underlying cardiovascular risk factors significantly increases your risk for developing cardiac complications both during and after cancer therapy. So it is very important to maintain a healthy lifestyle, both to reduce your risk of heart disease as well as recurrent or incident cancer. While you are undergoing cancer therapy, do not ignore other things such as blood pressure, lipids, etc., because controlling them effectively improves your longevity, not only by reducing long-term cardiovascular complications, but also by allowing you to complete your cancer therapy successfully. Again, insist on surveillance and correction of cardiac risk factors to get the best outcomes from your cancer therapy. And you have to be your own advocate to make sure that your doctors are doing what is needed, because again, everyone becomes very centric to the disease that they are focused on, not only the patients, but also the physicians. And it is often easy to ignore other things when you think that is your primary problem. But again, realize that health and your body is all one organ where there is significant interplay, and therefore you have to manage all your risk factors appropriately. Thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you so much. If everyone would put their questions in the chat and we will start to moderate them out, that would be great. If there's any questions, now's the time.
I hope it wasn't too technical, but if you have any questions that are not related to talk, but in general, please go ahead and ask.
Lots of thank yous in the chat. This is a great presentation, and you're awesome. Who should manage your cardiology symptoms? Primary care, survivorship provider, or in concert with a cardiologist?
So I think it depends. If you're just looking at surveillance, it can be done by your primary care as long as they're informed. And in general, when you finish cancer treatment, you should ask your cancer provider for a treatment summary. That is very important, and you are entitled to requesting that. That would be able to tell your primary care what you got, what it was. And often, if it's a good cancer center, they should even give you some sort of surveillance guideline. And your primary care could do that. If you do develop an actual cardiac complication, then you should be seen by a cardiologist.
If you have had very bad radiation burn to your chest, does that increase your risk significantly?
No, the radiation burn can be a very superficial thing. So that does not necessarily increase your risk of cardiac disease. It's more how much exposure your heart got. So the skin burn part is not correlated to the heart exposure.
Okay, thank you. The next question is, as patients treated in the 80s and 90s age, should they accelerate the intervals at which they are monitored? Example, moving from every 5 years to every 3 years?
No, not necessarily, because the guidelines really for the people monitored and who were treated in their 80s and 90s do recommend every 5 years or so. Once you have symptoms or any problems, then that screening interval goes up automatically because, you know, then you have a problem and it's not just a surveillance, it's more actual treatment of the problems.
Okay, thank you. All right, now they're coming in rapid fire. So is dysautonomia a reasonably common side effect or consequence of radiation or other treatment?
So dysautonomia is a consequence of radiation and other chemotherapies as well. It's not common, but it's not uncommon, I would say. I think if you have it, it's a relatively difficult problem to treat in general. It can vary from something simple like having a very revved up heart rate at baseline, which limits your exercise capacity, because when you try to do something, the heart rate skyrockets and you suddenly feel very limited in terms of shortness of breath or lightheadedness. In those situations, if your blood pressure permits, taking a beta blocker can be helpful. In general, exercise training is very important. So the more aerobic exercise you can do, the less you will suffer from dysautonomia. Some people can have problems where they have very low blood pressure and high heart rate, and that's very hard to treat. But there are certain medications that can be used in that instance, things like mestinon, things like midodrine, things like florinef, et cetera. So you really do need to see a doctor then to decide how to treat the dysautonomia.
Thank you. So I'm seeing more specific questions in the chat, and I just want to highlight for everyone that we can answer them generally, but not obviously specific to your care. But the next one says, how can the presence of a not concerning aortic aneurysm affect long-term cancer treatment?
It shouldn't. So basically, if you have an aortic aneurysm, the important thing is to control heart rate and blood pressure, because the higher the blood pressure and higher the heart rate, the more the repetitive stress on the aortic wall and the higher the risk of rupture. So really all you want to do is make sure that your blood pressure and heart rate are as low as possible without making you pass out. That would be the biggest, and you should get, you know, appropriate interval screening to make sure that the aneurysm is not growing at a rapid rate. And if and when it does grow to an appropriate rate, then the doctor would send you to have that taken care of, either with a stent or surgery, depending on the location of the aneurysm.
All right, thank you. So the next one says, hello, I'm a 59-year-old woman who had breast cancer 21 years ago with chemo and radiation. This past June had a recurrence with mastectomy and started on exemestane.
Yeah.
Is the best starting point to get echocardiogram? I think I have not had one for several years.
So exemestane does not increase your risk of cardiomyopathy. And if you got chemo and radiation in the past and you're completely asymptomatic at this point, there is a low likelihood that you have a cardiac complication of your cancer therapy. However, if they were to give you any further chemotherapy, like let's say you were to require adjuvant chemotherapy, either with anthracyclines or Herceptin, or any of the Herceptin analogs, then yes, you should insist on getting an echocardiogram before they start any kind of therapy.
Okay. And another one similar. I had left side mastectomy at 47 with radiation to chest. I have been feeling out of breath. I'm 54 now. Also dose dense chemo, AC/T, HER2 negative, and I'm on letrozole now. I was on tamoxifen for 2 years from 2015 to 2016. I have high LDL and taking rosuvastatin.
Rosuvastatin, HDL and triglycerides are optimal.
Yes.
Yeah, so if you are short of breath, you should ask your primary care doctor to do an echocardiogram. And if the echocardiogram shows normal cardiac function, You should even think about a stress test since you did get radiation to the chest. And if both of those are normal, then really, you should think about engaging in some kind of regular exercise program to improve your exercise capacity.
And the next question is specifically, does a survivorship program screen us for this?
Yes. Again, it depends upon your exposure and your risk. And if you are considered to be high risk, then yes, the survivorship program does screen for this. In some instances, your oncologist should be the one screening. If you got breast cancer, then they should be doing the echoes, et cetera. Not everyone is adherent to the guidelines to the extent that they should be. So again, the more informed you are and the more you can guide your own treatment, the better off you are.
Thank you. I don't see any other questions. Does anyone have anything else before we sign off? This recording will be posted in the next few days, just so everyone is aware.
So again, for the person who's a smoker and a high baseline heart rate, I would say that I hope you've quit smoking. That would be the best thing you could do for yourself. And if you're having a hard time doing that, the survivorship program does offer a smoking cessation program, and you can get into that through the ZACM Center as well. And again, if you have a high baseline heart rate, that usually suggests some degree of, inactivity or lack of aerobic tolerance and or dysautonomia. So again, for all of those things, regular aerobic exercise and the NCI as well as the cardiac societies all recommend 150 minutes of exercise a week, or if you're doing vigorous exercise, then 75 minutes of exercise a week. And I agree that the lockdown has been very difficult, but one of the, now that the weather is better, getting out and walking, even just outside, either with or without a mask, and staying away from kind of keeping your distance from other people, but walking outside is a very, very good activity. Or if you have stairs in your home, just go up and down the stairs, multiple times. There are always ways to exercise if there is a will.
All right. Well, thank you so much for your time today. And thank you for answering all these patient questions. It's been wonderful.